The Upanishad series. Can religion be without God? As such as we are, we cannot conceive of a religion which is without God. However, indeed, religion without God is the real religion. When God is the center of religion, we take many things for granted and skip our responsibilities. There is no one to rely upon. All responsibility is yours. Then you can grow. If all the time the child has to depend on someone, parents or this or that, his intelligence cannot grow. Knowing, only when he is left on his own, he stumbles upon, he strives on his own, explores, because he has to survive on his own, then his real talent comes onto the surface. Indeed, religion without God is the real religion, and all the rest are pseudo religions. All the religions of the East and West are God-oriented religions, excluding the religions that evolved around meditation. These are ritual based. Remove God from these religions, everything will fall flat on the ground. On the surface or circumference, you can only move round and round in circles. In the East, Buddha and Mahavir, they gave religion without God. These are the religions without God. Zen, Taoism are the religions without God. They are based on meditation. A new jump indeed. Buddha was quantum leap that made entire cosmos intoxicated with meditation. And these echoes continue to linger even after 25 centuries and have become stronger now and goes on becoming stronger day by day. God is the center of religion. In fact, lies outside you. This is superficial. The outside God is on the circumference. In such religions, God remains outside and there is no room for inward movement. Millions of people on earth have lost the quality of being shocked and begin inward movement. They have been hypnotized for centuries in such a way that no shock ever reaches them. All the so-called religions have been doing only one thing: creating shock absorbers in you so that you continue to move in circles. Religion is inner search and search for innerness. Search for the center of your being. Your innerness is the cosmic center within you. You have to search that. My function is to destroy all your shock absorbers and make you vulnerable and completely without any roots, so that the unwanted roots are cut off and you begin to grow new roots. Only then you will be able to discover your center, and then something begins to happen when your own roots grow. With Gautam Buddha, religion took a quantum leap. God became meaningless, only meditation became important. Buddha gave a godless meditation, where emphasis is on you. Remember, you can be transformed. You need to be transformed. You need to know your center. And when you have grown, you will know that which you call, with other religions, call God or cosmos or existence or whatsoever it is. With Buddha, God became meaningless and only meditation became important. Now, 25 centuries after Buddha, again religion is taking a quantum leap in your presence and becoming religionless. And now it is becoming religiousness. Religion is not important, but religiousness is important because it is the quality. Before Gautam Buddha, it was the first propounder of Jain religion, Adinath, who emphasized religion without God. The credit of bringing quantum leap in religion goes back 25 centuries. It was a tremendous revolution, because nowhere in the whole world had it ever been conceived that religion could exist without God. It was not conceived that religion can exist without God. God has been essential core of all the religions. Christianity, Judaism, Islam. However, when God becomes the center of religion, man comes on the periphery. When God is conceived as the creator of the world, man becomes a puppet. What can he do? And it is propounded that nothing can happen without the will of God. This is the reason in Hebrew, the language of Judaism, man is called Adam. Adam means mud. And in Arabic, man is known as Admi. It is from Adam. Again, it means mud. In English language, which became the language of Christianity, the word human comes from the root humus. And humus again means mud. This is important to understand. Naturally, if God is the creator, he has to create something from something. He makes man first as a statue out of mud and then breathes life into him. But if this is so, man loses his dignity, And if God is the creator of man and everything else, the whole idea is whimsical, because what has he been doing for eternity before he created man and the universe? According to Christianity, God created man only 4,400 years before Jesus Christ. The question comes, what was he doing all along through the eternity? This is whimsical. There cannot be any cause, because to have a cause for which God had to create existence means there are powers higher than God. There are causes which can make him create, or there is a possibility that suddenly desire arose in him. That too is not very philosophically sound, because all along he was desireless. And to be desireless is so blissful that it is impossible to conceive that out of an experience of eternal bliss, a desire arises in him and he decides to create the world. Indeed, a desire is a desire whether you want to make a house or create the world. And God cannot be conceived as having desires. So the only thing that remains is that maybe he was whimsical, eccentric. Then there is no need for cause and effect for desire. Just a whim is needed for him to create the world suddenly. But if this whole existence is just out of a whim, it loses all meaning and all significance as well. And tomorrow another whim may arise in him to destroy or dissolve the whole universe. So we are simply remaining a puppet in the hands of a God who has all the powers, but who has not have a sane mind. Nearly 5,000 years ago, Adinath must have been a deep meditator, and he must have come to the conclusion that with God there is no meaning in the world. If we want meaning in the world, then God has to be disposed of. He must have been a man of tremendous courage. People are still worshipping in the churches, in synagogues, in temples. Yet 5,000 years before us, Adinath came to be the first clear-cut scientific conclusion that there is nothing higher than man, and any evolution that is going to happen is within man and his consciousness, where the change has to happen. The change has to happen within your consciousness. You move to higher layers of consciousness. When you look at the Sufism, first of all, the seeker has to journey through various realms of nafs. And when he has transcended nafs, the lower emotions, then he reaches to the state of higher emotions, that is the seat, is known as kalb. And then he continues to move. So all emphasis is on consciousness, transformation, evolution, new birth, all has to happen within man, and man has to attain totality, not God. In a classroom, the teacher has already attained his degrees. If we consider him as God, everything revolves around him. When he comes, the class begins. When he is absent, the whole class is dispersed off for that day. It is the student who have to learn, transcend, and it is the students who has to attain wisdom and cross over to the next standard or next class. Man has to attain totality, not God. Therefore, the emphasis has to be on man. The whole emphasis of doctors and the hospitals is the sick. Hospitals are not meant for the healthy people. The moment you attain to health, you are released from the hospital, and the entire emphasis remains of sick. A transformation has to come in him. This was the first quantum leap God was disposed of, so that the emphasis has to shift from God to man. Man is important. When the first book, Meditation, The Way to Self-Realization, came in 2008, in the preface I wrote, "Do not ask philosophical questions like what was the relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene, or why did Ram abandon Sita," and things like these. These are not important. By knowing about those who are drunk and gone, what shall you gain? It is like inquiring from everyone about honeymoon. Honeymoon is a process. Just go into it and you will know what it is. You have to enter into the process in order to know what it is happening. One of the important words of Umar Khayyam is, "What shall you gain, O fools, by talking about those who are drunk and gone?" You want to know what does alcohol does? Take a sip and you will know what happens. By talking about those holy prophet, Ram, Krishna, all these people have attained. Look into their lives. What was the route that they followed that they attained? Talking about those is not going to help you in any way. This was the first quantum leap God was disposed of, so that the emphasis has to shift from God to man. I emphasized that do not ask me those philosophical questions, because that will not help you. My purpose is to bring about transformation in you, and transformation can happen only because I emphasize you. You are here, I am here, that is all that matters. And what happens between you and me is going to bring about the transformation in you. When you are vulnerable, open, you come early morning when sun is rising, it is free of the ultraviolet rays, nascent, and when those sun rays fall on you, it nourishes and nurtures your body. It gives you enough vitamin for the day. Nothing else is important. It is only man who needs transformation. naturally the emphasis has to shift from God to man. Although 5,000 years ago, Adinath came to this conclusion, however, it was Buddha indeed who gave this understanding a direction for a process to begin. He introduced the godless religion. With Buddha began a religion where God is no more important and the center. Instead, all emphasis shifted to man. Meditation techniques evolved. Vigyan Bhairav Tantra became the epitome of meditation and the instrument for the transformation of human consciousness. It is through breathing that you are connected with the cosmos. The breath comes from outside, it comes within you, and then it goes out. Breath bridges the outer and inner. As long as your emphasis remains centered on God, you will remain miserable. You will continue to believe that other is the cause of my misery. Nothing can happen in that situation. Nothing will happen except more and more misery. You know, how do we bring about our children? A child is walking, trying to make the steps. He tries to get to stand up, he falls down, he hits himself on the ground, he cries. And suddenly, in a mysterious look, he looks towards whoever is available. Mother. The mother comes rushing to the child, picks him up. And she says, the table hit you, the ground hit you, and she gives a gentle slap onto the table or to the ground. Why did you hit my child? And the child feels comfortable. Learn the first lesson of shifting the responsibility on others. Shifting the responsibility on others, and this continues lifelong. And with this, maturity does not come. Whatsoever is happening in my life, I am responsible for it. The moment you can say this authoritatively, you can, the doors for transformation will open for you. First, the realization has to come of your misery and that you are the cause. With this, your inward search can begin, not before that. Adinath is the first master of Jainism. And the credit does not go to Buddha, because Buddha comes 25 centuries after him. But another credit goes to Buddha. Adinath disposed of God but could not manage to put meditation in its place totally. On the contrary, he created asceticism, austerities, torturing the body, fasting, remaining naked, eating only once a day, not drinking in the night, not eating in the night, eating only certain foods. He had come to a beautiful philosophical conclusion, but it seems the conclusion, and he remained philosophical. Meditation did not become the way. When you dispose of God, you need something. So it was Buddha who actually gave it a direction. When you dispose of God, you cannot have any ritual, you cannot have worship, you cannot have prayer, and something has to be substituted. He substituted austerities because man became the center of religion and man has to purify himself. Purity in his conception was that man has to detach himself from the world, has to detach himself from his own body. This distorted the entire thing. He had come to a very significant conclusion, but it remained only a philosophical concept. That's why I emphasize, Adinath disposed of God, but he left a vacuum. Buddha filled it with meditation. Adinath made a godless religion. Buddha made a religion of meditation. A religion where meditation became most important. A religion of awareness. Meditation is Buddha's contribution. The question is not to torture the body, instead to become more silent, more relaxed, to become more peaceful. It is the beginning of inward journey to reach to one's own center of consciousness. And the center of one's own consciousness is indeed the center of the whole existence, the whole universe. 25 centuries have again passed. Just as Adinath's revolutionary concept of godless religion got lost in the desert of austerities and self-torture, so too Buddha's way of meditation, something inner, got lost in another desert, and that was organized religions. As long as Master is alive, there is light, there is awareness, and after him, business and the organized religion come in, and then you fall back into the desert again. Religion says that single individual cannot be trusted, whether they are meditating or not. They need communities, masters, monasteries, where they can live together. Those are on higher levels of consciousness, can watch over the others and help them. It became essential that religion should not be left in the hands of individuals. They should be organized and should be in the hands of those who have arrived at the high point of meditation. In the beginning, it was good. While Buddha was alive, there were many people who attained to enlightenment. But as Buddha died, and these people too died, the very organization that was supposed to help people to meditate fell in the hands of priesthood. And rather than helping you to meditate, they started creating rituals around the image of Buddha. All these priests were against Buddha when he was alive. The moment Buddha passed away, they took over the teachings of Buddha and started creating the organized religions around them. They realized in talking about Buddha means business. I have heard a conversation between three people. One was a Hindu, the next one was a Christian, and the third was a Jew. A question was asked, a Muslim, who you think is the greatest man on earth? The Muslim said, of course, who else could be? Holy Prophet. peace be upon him. Then he asked the Hindu, who else could be? It has to be Ram. It has to be Krishna, who gave the message of Bhagavad Gita to the world. Then they asked the Jew, who you think is the greatest man on earth? Listen to the answer of the Jew. He said, of course, Jesus got to be the center, the most important man. So the person said, but Jews do not like Jesus. So he replied, yes, I know it. In the heart of heart, I know it is Moses. But business is business. Jesus is the business mascot of Jews. All the most important and big businesses are owned by Jews. It is the Jews who created the birth of Jesus on 25th of December every year. It was a convenient time. When you go to the major metropolitan cities, all the businesses, Walt Disney, Walmart, all the major businesses, they are owned by Jews. So Jesus is the business mascot. It has become organized, part of the organized religion. After Buddha became another god. Adinath disposed of God. Buddha never accepted that God existed. But this priesthood cannot exist without God. So they created something. There may not be a God who is creator, but Buddha has reached the state of Godhood. For others, the only thing is to worship Buddha. Now, on the day when Buddha entered into the final meditation, thereafter he attained to enlightenment. He has become very frail. He could not cross the Niranjana river, the stony river. He was so frail and weak. He could not cross over the river. He fell, held on to the branch of a tree leaning from the other side of the other bank of the river, and he watched the stars disappear one after the other. Somehow he came out, he made a bed of leaves under the Bodhi tree, sat. Then a woman named Sujata, she came. She thought, it is the grace of the God that this godlike person has appeared in front of me. She offered him food on the platter, 49 different dishes, and offered a sweet rice kheer made out of rice and milk. And he sat down, having eaten, he decided to sit down in meditation. That was to continue until he attained. And when it happened, it was the cowherd boy and Sujata who saw the light coming from under the tree. It has engulfed the entire atmosphere. The plants, everything. Buddha was illumined with that. Now Buddhists follow this ritual. On the full moon night, when it is Buddha's anniversary, the day when he attained to enlightenment, it is not mere coincidence. Buddha was born on full moon day He attained to enlightenment on full moon day and finally attained to Mahaparinirvana too on full moon day. So on that day, they sit down, they eat the sweet rice, as if sweet rice is the cause and enlightenment was the effect. They sit down in the lotus posture. This is how the priesthood created the organized religion. For others, the only thing is to worship Buddha, to have faith in him, to follow the principles of Buddha, to live life according to his doctrine. And Buddha got lost in the organization, the imitation, but they all forget the basic thing, that was meditation. Buddha gave the meditation Anapanasati Yoga or Vipassana. Passana means to see. That is why one of the Hindu prayers say Passani Akshara Viyajatra. May I hear that which is auspicious. May I see that which is worth seeing. And these are the two most important things. If we have corrected the listening and the seeing, you can close your eyes and you will not see. But ears is something you cannot control. It is the most mischievous child. You try to control him one way or the other, he finds something or the other to do the mischief. Such is the nature of ears. You can close your eyes and you will not see it. But that does not happen with the ears. You take the ear plugs and plug it, you still you can hear. A lot of effort has to be made to train the ears to listen to that. And once you have trained these two sense organs or organs of perception, nothing else is needed. Om Bhadram Karne Vishunuyam Deva Bhadram Pashyami Akshara Viyajatra. The rest is all establishes or becomes established by itself. My whole effort is to create a religionless religion. We have seen what happened to religions which have gods as the center. We have seen what happened to Adinath's effort, revolutionary concept, godless religion. We have seen what happened to Buddha's organized religion without God. Just as they dissolved God, now there is need to dissolve religion as well. They dissolved God, now it's time to dissolve religion. Leave only meditation so that it is not forgotten. There is nothing else to replace. There is no God, there is no religion, only meditation is. Maybe after some time, the cunning mind may create the statues of meditation. So by religion, I mean an organized doctrine, creed, ritual, priesthood. And for the first time, I want religion to be absolutely individual. Absolutely individual, because all organized religions, whether with God or without God, have missed man. Man is the most important aspect. It is man who can be transformed. Nothing else. And the sole cause has been organization, because organization has its own ways which go against meditativeness. Organization is really a political phenomenon. It is not religious. It is another way to power and will to power. My effort is to destroy the priesthood completely. There is no need for God, no need for religion, no need for priest, no need for ritual. You alone are important and the center of the cyclone. You have to be transformed. Shiva has enumerated 112 techniques of meditation in response to the questions by his consort Devi. Then man is absolutely free. And unless you are totally responsible for your own growth, no transformation is possible. My feeling is that the more a man is responsible for his own growth, the more difficult it is for him to postpone it for long. You cannot postpone it if you realize that you are responsible for your growth, because postponing means you are responsible for your misery and no one else. If you are tense, you are responsible. If you are not relaxed, you are responsible. If you are in suffering, you are the cause of it. There is no God, no priesthood that you can go to and ask for some ritual. You are left alone with your misery and nobody wants to be miserable. Do you want to be miserable? If not, then stand up on your own feet and find a solution. You are given an intelligence, and when you do not know how to use your intelligence properly, tension is the outcome. When you do not know how to use your intelligence properly, tension is the outcome. The priest goes on giving you the false hope and tranquilizer not to be worried. It is just a test of your faith, of your trust. And if you can pass through this misery and suffering silently and patiently, in the other world, beyond death, you will be immensely rewarded. Not only that, they will keep on telling you that someone else is responsible for your misery. If there is no priesthood, you have to understand that whatever you are, you are responsible for it and no one else. And the feeling that I am responsible for my misery opens doors. Then you start looking for methods and means to get out of this miserable state. And that is what meditation is all about. A search for your own state of misery. It is simply the opposite state of misery, suffering, anguish and anxiety. It is a state of flowering of being into bliss, so silent and so timeless that you cannot conceive that anything better is ever possible. And there is nothing which is better than the state of a meditative mind. Adinath dropped God because God is becoming too heavy on man. Instead of helping him in his growth, God has become a burden. However, Adinath forgot to replace him with something else. Man will need something in his miserable moments. He used to pray to God. You have taken God and prayer away from him. Now he will be more miserable. What will he do? In Jainism, there is no room for meditation. Just the austerities, fasting, and torturing the body. It is Buddha's insight to see that God too is dropped. When God is dropped, there is a gap, and that gap needs to be fulfilled. Otherwise, the gap will destroy man. Buddha brought in meditation. Meditation is indeed something really authentic which can change the whole being. Meditation brings about transformation. With meditation, inward journey begins. It gives you the realization now you are taking the total responsibility for your life. But Buddha was not aware of certain things. And perhaps he could not be aware because there are things which you cannot be aware unless they actually happen. Buddha failed to realize that there should be no organization, no priesthood either. Buddha erred. Once God is gone, religion should also be dissolved. Only then man can indeed be free and responsible. Certainly Buddha can be forgiven because he had not thought about it, and there was no past to help him either to see it. The organization came after him. The real problem is the priest. Remember, God is the invention of the priest. It is the conspiracy to manipulate man that God was invented by the priest. Unless you drop the priest, you cannot drop God. But priest is always there to find new rituals, new ways and means. He will create new gods. And thus the innovation of the priest continues. The man remains yoked to these rituals. Although my effort is to leave you alone with meditation, meditation connects you to your being and thus to the existence. Maybe after some time, something comes into existence. When you are not in meditation, you are separated from the existence, and that is your suffering. You are separated from the existence. It is the same as when you take a fish out of the ocean and throw it on the bank. The fish goes through misery and suffering. This brings deep hankering and the effort to reach back to the ocean, because it is where the fish really belongs. Fish is the part of the ocean, and it cannot remain separate. All suffering indicates you are not in communion with existence. Meditation is nothing but withdrawing all barriers, thoughts, emotions and feelings that create a barrier between you and the existence. The moment they drop, you suddenly find yourself in tune with the whole. Then you are not only in tune, instead you really find you are the whole. When a dew drop slips from the lotus leaf into the lake, it does not find that it is a part of the ocean. It finds that it is ocean. And to find it is the ultimate goal, the ultimate realization. There is nothing beyond it. Adinath dropped God, but did not drop organization. And in the absence of God, the organization created rituals, and rituals became new obstruction. Buddha realized that Jainism had become ritualistic way. Buddha dropped all rituals and single-pointedly emphasized on meditation. However, he too forgot that priests who has made Jainism ritualistic are going to do the same thing with him. Indeed, they did it. They made Buddha himself a god. They talked about meditation, but basically Buddhists are worshippers of Buddha. They go to the temple, and instead of Krishna and Christ, there are Buddha's statues. I heard one winter night a Zen master came to a temple. It was a cold winter night. There was hundreds of wooden statues of Buddha. The night was so cold, it was unbearable. He burned one of the statues of the Buddha, and to maintain the warmth around. And in the morning when the priest got up, he was angry that why did he burn one of the statues of the Buddha. So the Zen master replied, Buddha, the outer Buddha was burned to save the inner Buddha. The outer Buddha was burned to save the inner Buddha. So these priests talk about meditation, but basically Buddhists are worshippers of Buddha. They go to the temple and instead of Krishna and Christ, there is Buddha's statue. There was no statue of Buddha for 500 years after him. In Buddhist temple, they just had the tree under which Buddha became enlightened, engraved on marble, just a symbol. Buddha was not there, only the tree. You are here. The whole existence too is available. All that you need is just to be silent and listen to existence. There is no need for any religion, God, priesthood, or any organization. Just sit in your table, in your office. Start watching your breath as it comes in and reaches to the solar plexus. It turns and then it makes an upward movement. One moment before there was no breath within, it was outside. Then as you inhale, it comes into you, made its downward descent, reached to the solar plexus. That's where it reaches up to. And it is through the solar plexus that once you were connected through the umbilical cord to the mother's womb, now you are establishing the same connection with the existence. Existence becomes a greater womb. And you will realize that something is beginning to happen. My effort through these talks is to give you the same experience. What you will gain in meditation, what you will gain in inhaling and exhaling as you are listening to this talk, you will find that something settles and becomes silent in you. Your body becomes still. Breath becomes so silent as if you are not breathing at all. You are not aware of the breathing at the moment. The choice of the words, the modulation, the energy field that these words carry beyond time and space. You may be far away from me, but that distance does not matter. That distance does not matter for energy to reach to you. And these meditation talks are available in the form of videos on YouTube through live streaming. they will also be available on timeline of the Facebook. You can go on listening to one talk alone, and I can assure you, while you are listening to it with the eyes closed, even if it happens for a few moments, certainly it will happen. You do not know what has happened to you. You disappear into your own inner silence. Certainly it will happen. When I do listen to these talks while I am editing the audio, it happens. So I know the effect of these is contagious. Only this much for this morning until Saturday.